What's up, Black Sheep Church? It's Wednesday. Time for that Bible study. Old Testament timeline. We are going to hit Jacob again. We're going to do a little bit better job with that. We're going to move into Moses, Egypt, the Exodus, all that good stuff. Oh, here I am. See? Messing up already. For those of you who don't know, on April 18th at Saratoga Lake Park, over there by Sunsplash, right off of Santa Barbara, we are going to be having an ordination ceremony for Lisa Bove? See? I keep messing it up. I'm sorry, Lisa. Excuse me. You guys are invited. There's going to be a little bit of food, you know, little celebration going on there. So if you're interested in that, reach out to us. April 18th at 3 p.m. Yeah, let's get started on some worship, then we'll hit this good stuff and get on with this night. Know what I'm saying? All right, guys. This is Battle Belongs by Phil Wickham. blacksheepchurch.org for all your Black Sheep Church needs. If you are somebody who tithes or you would like to bless Black Sheep Church with a donation or a love offering, you could do that at blacksheepchurch.org there. We are a 501c3. Everything is tax deductible if you itemize. So if you could help out, that's great. We are currently at the start of raising funds for a church home. If you can help out with that, if you go to Facebook, this is originally broadcast on Facebook. This will show up on YouTube later tonight. But if you're watching this on YouTube, go to the Facebook, Black Sheep Church Facebook page, and on there, there is a fundraiser. If you donate through that fundraiser, it is no fees to us whatsoever. So you can go to the blacksheepchurch.org and donate through there, no problem. If you go to the Facebook page, though, that's zero fees, and that will specifically be used for a church home, community center slash thrift store home. So that's the differences in those two things. Both are tax deductible, all that good stuff. So it is Wednesday. So we are approaching this time in Jesus's life. You know, that's an interesting thing I would like to point out. I have made as simple of an attempt as possible to highlight where we're at right now in time, in this world, etc. We have the 100-year anniversary of the Islamic Caliphate. It was disbanded in 1924. We are coming upon the 100th anniversary to that. We're currently seeing that set up right now, and Turkey seems to be the head of it. We're going to see a rebirth of that. We have a coming conflict with China. We have problems with Israel. Israel was reborn in 1947 after 1900 years of not being in existence whatsoever. That has never been done. Right, we can go on and on and on. There's all these things. If you've been following for long, you've heard most of this stuff. I would just like to point out that the 2,000-year anniversary of Christ being crucified is coming up not that far off. Right? Most people give that date of 33 A.D. You know, some go up to 39, 36, right? But basically, most people believe that was 3380. So literally 12 years from now, we hit the 2,000-year anniversary of the most amazing thing that's ever happened. God, who sacrifices his son himself on a cross for those he loves, not demanding anything from us except our loyalty to him. That's it. Love me, he says. Bow the knee, come into my kingdom. I will forgive you everything. You don't have to bring anything to the table. I understand you are a complete beggar. So God says, I will do this job that no human being can do. So I will come as a human being, and I will do that job so that I can be reconciled to my children, so that I can set things right after the fall. We can bring restoration to this relationship between humanity and God. I'm sorry, just today while I was studying for this, it just struck me. Not that that's anything. That's not a prophecy or anything like this. Yeah. We're going to go back to Jacob. As you know, Jacob become Israel, wrestled with God. Israel has 12 sons. These 12 sons become the 12 tribes of Israel. These 12 sons were, this is Genesis chapter 35, verse 23. Jacob had 12 sons. the sons of Leah, Reuben, the firstborn of Jacob. So these are the sons of Leah, and out of those, the firstborn out of all of Jacob's children was Reuben. Then from Leah here, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, and Zebulun. With Rachel, his second wife, he had Joseph and Benjamin. With Rachel's maidservant, this makes three, if you're keeping count. Dan and... yeah. Naphtal, I always get that one. It's a rough one for me. And with Leah's maidservant, Gad and Asher. So that's Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, and Zebulun, Joseph, Benjamin, Dan, Naphtal, Gad, and Asher. These were the sons of Jacob who were born to him. So one of these sons, Joseph, is the last one. He was the last one born. This is chapter 37. Jacob wrestles with God, becomes Israel, has these children. These are the 12 tribes. We have the promise made to, we have the covenant with Abraham, promising his descendants this land. We also have this covenant where Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, imputed righteousness, that like we receive from Christ, he received it then. And Joseph, well, chapter 37, Genesis 37. Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed, the land of Canaan. This is the account of Jacob. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and he brought their father a bad report about them. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons, because he had been born to him in his old age, and he made a richly ornamental robe for him. Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoats, right? You guys remember that at all? And he made a richly ornamented robe for him. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field, when suddenly my sheaf..." Okay, so this is like, you know, the stalk with the seed on top, right? So imagine, they're bundling all these up. "When suddenly my sheaf rose and stood up right..." "And stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it." So this is the youngest brother. His brothers look at him and they go, "Do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he had said. Then he had another dream, and he told it to his brothers. So if telling them about the first dream wasn't bad enough, he's... right. "Listen," he said, "I had another dream, and this time the sun and moon and 11 stars were bowing down to me." When he told his father as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, "What is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you?" His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. This is the great Israel. And he's like, what? I'm bowing down to you, my youngest son? Huh? So Israel has his sons out doing some stuff and takes his favorite with his Technicolor dream coat and sends him to his brothers. The brothers get a wild hair up their butt and they decide, hey, we're going to take their Mr. Ruler and we're going to kill him. We're going to take that fancy coat of his off of him. We're going to throw him in this well here and we're going to put some blood and stuff on this. And we're going to tell Dad that a wild animal must have gotten him. And about this time, they see a caravan off in the distance. And it was merchants heading to Egypt. And they decided it was a better idea to sell their brother for 20 pieces of silver to the caravan going to Egypt. That was a mistake by them. Because Joseph... Joseph wasn't an ordinary man. He goes to Egypt and he starts excelling. He's very intelligent. God blesses him in all he does. And over a little bit of time, he works his way up into Pharaoh's house. And eventually, Pharaoh says, hey, you are so incredible. I'm going to let you handle the kingdom. I'm going to go party, and you can handle all my business. You have the power of the kingdom. This is how much he trusts him. So here he is, the son of Israel, in command of Egypt. The youngest to 11 other brothers. The story should have ended when they threw him in the well. That's where that story should have ended. But like always, God steps in. Mind you, let's this firstborn thing, right? I mean, God has a history of using. I mean, yeah. Joseph's 12th born. He shouldn't be in this place whatsoever. And he's ruling over Egypt. There is a famine that is happening. And so Israel and his sons are experiencing hardship. So there's a couple trips made to Egypt for grain. And the 11 brothers This is chapter 45. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all his attendants, and he cried out, "Have everyone leave my presence." So there was no one with Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers. You see, nobody in Egypt knew that those 11 dudes who were coming for grain were his brothers. He didn't tell anybody. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him anyways. And Pharaoh's household heard about it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still living?" But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. Imagine, there is the brother who you sold into slavery. First, you throw him down a well. Then you pull him out of the well and you sell him to some slave traders and you're like, "Hey, we hate you. Go die." And you come face to face with Pharaoh's right-hand man, and this is your brother who you tried to kill. That is terrifying. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come close to me." When they had done so, he said, "I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here. Because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you." Did you hear that? It was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now, there has been famine in the land. And for the next 5 years, there will not be plowing and reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So then, it was not you who sent me here, but God. He made me father to Pharaoh, lord of his entire household and ruler of all Egypt. Here we see selflessness. There are shadows of Christ all over this. Any other man would have taken his 11 brothers, found out his dad was still alive, they would have sent troops to go get dad, and would have slaughtered his 11 brothers. They absolutely hated him. They told him. It wasn't a secret. And even though they hated him, he still loved them. How many times has that been you? How many times do you not want to deal with God? How many times have you hated God? Hi. And he still loves you. So, Joseph brings the family to Egypt. The family lives good. They have a great time for a while. Pharaoh dies, and a new Pharaoh comes to a power. And he's not kind to Joseph. And he says, "Hey, there's lots of these Israelites going on around here. I'm thinking we shouldn't be so nice to them." And before you know it, Israel, the nation state Israel, these 12 tribes, have amassed great numbers of people, and they are now being put into slavery because Egypt has figured out, the Pharaoh has figured out, we have to do something with them or they're going to overthrow us. And so, last week, the week prior, Abraham finds out that his descendants are going to be numerous as the stars. He's going to get this land, so on and so forth. But God says, "Hey, for 430 years, your people are going to be, they're going to be hemmed up. And be bound in slavery." This is how that happened. It happened so that the family line of Israel and Israel himself could stay alive. This horrible thing in Joseph's life became this big, beautiful thing that God did. The suffering and the torment that Joseph went through saved his dad and his family and the whole line. Because of that famine, they probably wouldn't have made it through. And there would have been no nation Israel. And there wouldn't have been God's chosen people. And there wouldn't have been a Christ, because Christ is a Jew. He's an Israelite. So, here we are. We are in Egypt now. The Jews have been slaves for a while. This Pharaoh, who's making it real hard on the Jews, he's like, hey, don't give them no straw for their bricks now. Don't, right? And this servitude that they're putting the Jews under gets harder and harder. Up to the point Pharaoh says, hey, listen. He says, I want you to kill all the firstborn males. And the midwives, they're delivering Jewish babies, and they're not killing the males, even though Pharaoh's commanded it. They're lying to Pharaoh and saying, hey, listen, these Jewish ladies are awesome. They just drop these babies they're just like popping out before we can get there. So then finally he's like, okay, listen, I need you to throw them in the river. From here on out, the decree is all male Jewish babies get thrown in the river. So Moses' mom and dad, they are from the tribe of Levi. Moses is born, and they're supposed to throw him in the river. But mom holds on to Moses for 3 months or so, a little while. And then when the heat gets on, Moses goes into a basket, into like a wicker basket, a floating wicker basket, and he gets put on the river. Pharaoh's daughter, chances, right? Do you believe in chances? I don't really believe in chances. So Moses goes into the river in a basket. Pharaoh's daughter happens to be down the river and finds this baby floating along. She takes the baby out of the river and she takes the baby home. So now Moses, an Israelite from the tribe of Levi, is brought into the palace. He's raised there. He's a young adult, and he sees what's going on to the how the Israelites are being mistreated and abused. And one day he gets really upset because he sees them being abused, and Moses goes and Moses kills a man. Buries the body, gets afraid, and runs away. He's done with it. He's like, count me out. So he goes away, he gets himself a wife. His father-in-law is a priest. And one day, Moses is out, and he sees a bush, and it's on fire. And he's like, huh, that should have burned out by now. What's up with this bush? So he goes to check it out. He shows up, and he gets yelled at by God because he's got his shoes on in the house. God's like, Moses, hey, check it out. This ground's holy. Take your shoes off. Moses does. Next thing you know, Moses is being told he's got to go back. This is Exodus chapter 3. Now, Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. He led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God, where the angel of the Lord appeared to him in the flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over there and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up? When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush. Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. Remember, the Amorites had not been, they weren't far enough gone in their sin yet? Well, God's saying they are now. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name by which I am to be remembered from generation to generation. Go assemble the elders of Israel and say to them, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you and have seen what has been done to you in Egypt. And I have promised to bring you up out of your misery in Egypt into the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, a land flowing with milk and honey. The elders of Israel will listen to you. Then you and the elders are to go to the king of Egypt and say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. Let us take a 3-day journey into the desert to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. So I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go. Verse 21, and I will make the Egyptians favorably disposed toward this people, so that when you leave, you will not go empty-handed. Every woman is to ask her neighbor and any woman living in her house for articles of silver and gold and for clothing, which you will put on your sons and daughters, and so you will plunder the Egyptians. So God's going to hook them up, make them rich. I mean, not rich, but kind of rich. Chapter 4. Moses answered, what if they do not believe me or listen to me and say the Lord did not appear to you? Then the Lord said to him, What is that in your hand? A staff. The Lord said, throw it on the ground. Moses threw it on the ground and it became a snake. And he ran from it. Then the Lord said to him, reach out your hand and take hold of the snake. And it turned back into a staff in his hand. This, said the Lord, is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has appeared to you. Then the Lord said, put your hand inside your cloak. So Moses put his hand into his cloak. And when he took it out, it was leprous like snow. Skin disease. People who have leprosy. Back in those days, it was kind of a generic term for lots of different skin issues. Your skin turns white. You can have pieces of your body fall off, right? It's disgusting, unclean, and you were not allowed. You're not allowed to be unclean and be in the tribe. But this is just a show of power. This is not an actual sickness or disease or anything. Now put it back in your cloak, he said. So Moses put his hand back into his cloak, and when he took it out, it was restored like the rest of his flesh. Then the Lord said, if they do not believe you or pay attention to the first miraculous sign, they may believe the second. But if they do not believe these two signs or listen to you, take some water from the Nile and pour it on the dry ground. The water you take from the river will become blood on the ground. Moses said to God, O Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue. He's a stutterer. The Lord said to him, who gave man his mouth? Who makes him deaf or mute? Who gives him sight or makes him blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, I will help you speak and will teach you what to say. Verse 13. But Moses said, O Lord, please send someone else to do it. Verse 14. Then the Lord's anger burned against Moses. What a great dad. Moses, listen, I'm going to handle this for you. Go do what I'm telling you to do. Dad, listen, I stutter. I don't know how to speak in front of people. I mean, send somebody else. So now Dad raises his voice a little bit. Then the Lord's anger burned against Moses, and he said, what about your brother Aaron the Levite? I know he can speak well. Called gritted teeth. I'm sure that's how that happened. He is already on his way to meet you, and his heart will be glad when he sees you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. He will speak to the people for you, and it will be as if he were your mouth and as if you were God to him. But take this staff in your hand so you can perform miraculous signs with it. So Moses and Aaron go to Egypt. They go through a series of different events with Pharaoh. They bust out the staff and the snake trick. Let's go to chapter 7. Verse 8. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, when Pharaoh says to you, perform a miracle, then say to Aaron, take your staff and throw it down before Pharaoh, and it will become a snake. So Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and did just as the Lord commanded. Aaron threw his staff down in front of Pharaoh and his officials, and it became a snake. Pharaoh then summoned wise men and sorcerers. And the Egyptian magicians also did the same things by their secret arts. Each one threw down his staff, and it became a snake. But Aaron's staff swallowed up their staffs. Yet Pharaoh's heart became hard, and he would not listen to them, just as the Lord had said. This is the cycle. I do want to highlight, though, Egyptian magicians also did the same things by their secret arts. So, for my friends who don't believe in magic or sorcery or witchcraft or these things, if you're a Christian and you believe in your Bible, are you saying this is lying? This is not the only place we find confirmation that this stuff is real and exists. So we get the plague of blood, the plague of frogs. This is on and on, Moses and Aaron going to Pharaoh like, hey, listen, God says let us go. We're supposed to go worship. And Pharaoh's like, okay. And then he says no. And then he says okay. And then he says no. And it's this no. And it's no. And it's no. And every time God says, no, listen, you got to let him go. And so something else happens to Egypt. You would call this like a disciplining, right? God is strategically increasing these plagues and punishments against Israel to break them to a point that they will let Israel go. So he's punishing Egypt. He's disciplining Egypt. Let my people go. Showing his power and his strength in the process. Plague of gnats, plague of flies. There's a plague on the livestock. There was a plague of boils that broke out all over people's skins. plague of hail. A plague of locusts. Plague of darkness for 3 days. Plague on the firstborn. Chapter 11, verse 1. Now the Lord had said to Moses, I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt, and after that he will let you go from here. And when he does, he will drive you out completely. Tell the people that men and women alike are to ask their neighbors for articles of silver and gold. The Lord made the Egyptians favorably disposed toward the people, and Moses himself was highly regarded in Egypt by Pharaoh's official and by the people. So Moses said, this is what the Lord says. About midnight, I will go throughout Egypt. Every firstborn son in Egypt will die. From the firstborn son of Pharaoh who sits on the throne to the firstborn son of the slave girl who is at her handmill, and all the firstborn of the cattle as well. There will be loud wailing throughout Egypt, worse than there has ever been or ever will be again. But among the Israelites, not a dog will bark at any man or animal. Then you will know that the Lord makes a distinction between Egypt and Israel. All these officials of yours will come to me, bowing down before me and saying, go, you and all the people who follow you. After that, I will leave. Then Moses, hot with anger, left Pharaoh. The Lord had said to Moses, Pharaoh will refuse to listen to you, so that my wonders may be multiplied in Egypt. Moses and Aaron performed all these wonders before Pharaoh, but the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let the Israelites go out of his country. This is chapter 12. This is talking about Passover. We've been talking about this week, right? Holy Week, Passion Week, whatever you want to call it, this final week of Jesus' life. We've been talking about Passover. Jesus is God's Passover lamb. This is the account of Passover. The first one. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, this month is to be for you the first month. The first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family. One for each household. If any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one, blah, blah, blah. So it gives a breakdown as to what they need to do. Don't leave any till morning. If some is left till morning, you must burn it. So there's this whole thing. Verse 12, on that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. So you sacrifice the lamb, you take the blood, you paint it on the doorpost, the top part of the door jamb and the side posts, and this protects you. This is a day you are to commemorate for the generations to come. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance. For 7 days you are to eat bread made without yeast. On the first day, remove the yeast from your houses. For whoever eats anything with yeast in it from the first day through the seventh must be cut off from Israel. So, simply consuming yeast on any of these 7 days, you had to be cut off from Israel. Family, everything, goodbye. On the first day, hold a sacred assembly, and another one on the seventh day. Do no work at all on these days, except to prepare food for everyone to eat. That is all you may do. Celebrate the Feast of Unleavened Bread, because it was on this very day that I brought your divisions out of Egypt. Celebrate this day as a lasting ordinance for the generations to come. Verse 21, then Moses summoned all the elders of Israel and said to them, go at once and select the animals for your families and slaughter the Passover lamb. Take a bunch of hyssop, dip it into the blood in the basin, and put some of the blood on the top and on both sides of the doorframe. Not one of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning. When the Lord goes through the land to strike down the Egyptians, he will see the blood on the top and sides of the doorframe and will pass over that doorway. And he will not permit the destroyer to enter your houses and strike you down. Obey these instructions as a lasting ordinance for you and your descendants. When you enter the land that the Lord will give you as he promised, observe this ceremony. And when your children ask you, what does this ceremony mean to you? Then tell them, it is the Passover sacrifice to the Lord, who passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt and spared our homes when he struck down the Egyptians. Then the people bowed down and worshipped. The Israelites did just what the Lord commanded Moses and Aaron. At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborn in Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on the throne to the firstborn of the prisoner who was in the dungeon, and the firstborn of all livestock as well. Pharaoh and all his officials and all the Egyptians got up during the night. There was loud wailing in Egypt, for there was not a house without someone dead. Eventually, Pharaoh's like, yep, they gotta go. So the Egyptians have given them all kinds of wealth, because God inclined their hearts to that. And now it's time for the Israelites to go. So they take off. And then Pharaoh gets upset. And he decides to go after him. Most of you probably know the story of the Red Sea. Moses parts the Red Sea. So there's some trickery played by Moses. They end up camping at the side of the Red Sea. Overnight, the wind blows. Pharaoh's army is coming down upon Moses and the Israelites. Morning breaks. There is a clear pathway. When Moses sticks his staff over the water, bam, dry ground. They start running across. They get out the other side. And Moses turns around, and God lets the water fall back into the ravine he created and destroys Pharaoh's armies. Now Israel is safe. They go back to that same mountain Moses was at with the burning bush. So here you have this giant caravan of people. When they are set up at the base of this mountain, the number that I have seen most commonly was around 600,000 people at the base of a mountain. It's like a desert, but there's a mountain there, right? And so they have this town, this city set up all around this mountain. This is a lot of people. God calls to Moses. The Israelites trusted Moses. They got him out of the stuff. He got him out of Egypt. God used Moses to get them out of Egypt. This is Exodus 19. In the third month after the Israelites left Egypt, on the very day they came to the desert of Sinai. After they set out from Rephidim, they entered the desert of Sinai, and Israel camped there in the desert in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, "This is what you are to say to the house of Jacob, and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt and how I carried you on eagle's wings There are some who want to say the eagle's wings talked about in Revelation is the United States. I beg to differ with them. Israel was given eagle's wings when they left Egypt and brought you to myself. Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites." So Moses went back and summoned the elders of the people and set before them and the words the Lord had commanded him to speak. The people all responded together, "We will do everything the Lord has said." So Moses brought their answer back to the Lord. Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to come to you in a dense cloud so that the people will hear me speaking with you and will always put their trust in you." Then Moses told the Lord what the people had said. The Lord said to Moses, "Go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day. Because on that day, the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all people. Put limits for the people around the mountain and tell them, 'Be careful that you do not go up the mountain nor touch the foot of it. Whoever touches the mountain shall surely be put to death. He shall surely be stoned or shot with arrows. Not a hand is to be laid on him. Whether man or animal, he shall not be permitted to live. Only when the ram's horn sounds a long blast may they go up to the mountain." (Clears throat) On the morning of the third day, let's jump down here to verse 16. There was thunder and lightning with a thick cloud over the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp trembled. Then Moses led the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord descended on it in fire. The smoke billowed up from it like smoke from a furnace. The whole mountain trembled violently, and the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder. Then Moses spoke, and the voice of God answered him. The Lord descended to the top of Mount Sinai and called Moses to the top of the mountain. So Moses went up, and the Lord said to him, "Go down and warn the people so they do not force their way through to see the Lord, and many of them perish. Even the priests who approach the Lord must consecrate themselves, or the Lord will break out against them." Moses said, "The people cannot come up Mount Sinai because you yourself warned us, put limits around the mountain, and set it apart as holy." The Lord replied, "Go down and bring Aaron up with you, but the priests and the people must not force their way through to come up to you, to come up to the Lord, or he will break out against them." So Moses went down to the people and told them. Here is where we find the Ten Commandments. Chapter 20 in the book of Exodus. This is the beginning of the law of God, the Mosaic law, the law of Moses. All three of these things are this. These are rules and regulations to govern the people, group, / nation, state of Israel. They are given to Moses and Aaron. They do not have a governmental structure. They just left Pharaoh. They are as big as a nation state. They have no way of ruling themselves. They have no one to rule them. They have Moses, who represented them in front of Pharaoh. But how will they rule, etc.? And God says, "Hey, I'll make a deal with you guys. Look, I saved you. I love you guys. I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right? I'm going to set this people group apart. You're going to be my people. I'm going to love you. You guys are going to love me. You're going to follow my rules, and we're going to go far." There are 613 rules and regulations in the Mosaic Law. You have broken many more than you even know existed. If you break a law or rule, regulation, whatever you want to call them, in the law of God, there is a process in which you have to be cleansed. There is a sacrifice that has to be made. There is a process to bring you back into right relationship with God. Nobody was able to do this correctly. Nobody was strong enough to live the perfect life. Nobody could stand the weight of the law of God. When we look into the perfect law, it screams how much of a deficit we're at. If you are attending a church and it's nothing but self-help stuff telling you how great you are, you're probably not in a biblical church. Because, listen, you could be great by the world standards. You could be awesome. The outside of your cup, you may wash that and it might look all sparkly and nice, and you got the latest cars and the nicest things and so on and so forth. But the compared against the law of God, you're trash. I'm trash. I know the law pretty good. I stare into it often to remind myself just how big of a deficit I'm at. Just how much he must love me to die for somebody like me. So Israel is given the law. governed by. It's a theocracy. God is their king. We see Moses set up the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant contains the Ten Commandments. Some other items, but the two tablets of the Ten Commandments are in the Ark of the Covenant. God sat on top, in spirit form, sat on top of the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant with his people on earth. The sacrificial system went on around the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenant. Around God on earth. Israel, like we know, is constantly in this state of doing good, following the law pretty good, and doing bad. And rebellion, and then acceptance. And rebellion, and it's this rocky thing. And God keeps having to discipline and to punish them. This is all based on this law. The work that we're watching Jesus do right now this week, almost 2,000 years ago, he is God's Passover lamb. They are preparing for the Passover feast. So Israel, all around him, is celebrating Passover. They're having their own sacrifices for their own households. And here is Jesus. Here God is with his sacrifice for this very special Passover. This man, Jesus, who was never at fault. He never sinned. He was not born with sin. It was a virgin birth. He was not born with sin. He never violated a single one of the Mosaic laws. Law of God, whatever. Those 613 rules and regulations. Perfect. The perfect sacrifice. Not a blemish on him. Did what no man could do. Followed that law to the T. Proving he was the Messiah. Have you watched The Passion of the Christ yet? Use your imagination. Some would say that portraying the Jesus in any way is wrong because you're trying to portray the image of God, and that's wrong. But if you can let go of that legalistic side there, and you can bring yourself to imagine Christ on that day or to watch that movie, understand this man is innocent of all charges. Everything against him, he's innocent of. He does not deserve what is happening to him. He's the one person ever who doesn't deserve it. The one ever. He is the fulfillment of the law. He earned the right to set us free. He earned it. He did the work. He did the work so that you and I could live. And we could live abundantly. And we can live as his family in his kingdom. I cannot wait for those days. I have stuff to do now. I have a family I love so very much here. And there's work for me to do here now. But man, when it is our time to be in that kingdom with him, there are no words for the fulfillment that you will feel. Safety, security, a knowing of just being you is enough. Living in the presence of God. Not because you can follow the rules, but because you believe him and it's credited to you as righteousness. I am late. Friday morning, there'll be a video from me. And we're going to discuss Good Friday. We're going to talk about the things Jesus experienced. And then we'll be back here Sunday morning. We normally on Sunday evenings, we will be here Sunday morning. Look for us around 7 a.m. Eastern. 7 a.m., 7:10, somewhere in there. I'll do my best. I will, 7:10 on Sunday morning. Sunrise is like 7:30. So we will be live way before then. Lord willing. Okay, I heard you. Lord willing. Lord willing. Please reflect on your relationship with Christ. Say hi to him if you haven't done that in a while. If you have not bowed the knee, if you have not given your life to Christ, join me in prayer now if you would like to. Father, we come to you tonight, beggars. The law of God shows us that we lack. We could never live up to what's contained in that law, Lord. We repent of being self-centered. We repent in wanting our way, in wanting to be our own gods, Father. Lord, tonight we come to you and beg for you to accept us into your family. To love us, Lord. To take the enmity that you feel for us when we are unsaved and replace that with your love, Father. Please accept us dirty, filthy, ragamuffin children. Bring us into your kingdom, Father. Let us stand in your presence all the days of eternity, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That is where the journey begins. Those who seek me shall find me. You have to seek him. When you love somebody, when you're in love with them, you want to be with them. You want to spend time with them. Seek him. If you love him, seek him. I will see you guys Friday morning sometime. I love you. Chins up. Be the light. Do what you can when you can. Lord, praise you for Cowboy. We love you.